Everybody tired yet? Been a long week, huh? Well, we're going to jam through this and have some fun today. Quick agenda, we're going to do the story of how we started doing these. We're going to talk about themes for hacking demos. We're going to talk about making these demos effective in educating your end users. And we're going to talk about some creation tips. So let's go ahead and jump right in. If I was standing in front of you today and this was a support group, such as AA or something like that, I would stand here and say, my name is Dan, and I work for the government. Because you see, government is dysfunctional, we all know that, and government does not always equate to governance. As a matter of fact, within our organization, we actually have about 30 different businesses. And each one of those businesses has a different data that they have to protect, a different risk tolerances, and to be honest with you, different levels of just giving a damn. Okay, you have organizations such as criminal justice. You have a sheriff's department, local police departments, a 911 center. They have criminal justice information that they have to protect. In the same organization, you have one of the largest social services agencies in entire California, and they have a ton of PII. Big health department with a ton of PHI. Then within the same organization, not the same network, by the way, so don't get any ideas, but within the same organization, you have public entities in government. For them, everything's public. And then you have a library where they want to tell you, hey, just turn off the firewall. We're all one big happy fleet. And so as a result of this massive diversity of different departments and their attitudes towards things, we had a problem when I first became CSO. We were using stock awareness presentations, and those presentations we had tweaked a little bit for our organization, but in reality, they weren't really enough to get everybody to want to participate in security awareness training. It was just another event. And most of you are probably familiar with this sort of thing where you just have to do the training, it's a checkbox, and you know, oftentimes it's boring. So we looked at our numbers, which were around, it was as bad as 55%. We went, you know what, we need to do something to change this. And it's not gonna happen from a governance perspective. It needs to happen from the perspective of getting end users interested and wanting to see this stuff. So we needed to get their attention. Now, I was at the RSA conference, it was about 6 years ago, and I was watching a presentation that was happening where they showed a video of some Chinese APT activity on the screen. And I thought, you know, this would be very interesting to offer to our end users the ability to show up to some sort of live awareness training where we could talk about this sort of thing and talk about some advanced attacks and how attackers do their thing. And so we decided to offer that in our first year in doing live awareness training. Now understand, this was not a hacking demo. This was our first year of just offering live awareness training as an option for our users. We still had the online versions available so people could do that, but we decided that we'd sit them down in large groups in the board chambers and various other places and talk to them about how computer crime works and focus on both personal and business security. This is really important, and we'll get into this a little bit more in a second. In this particular one, we talked about how malware and nuisance attacks work. We talked about how targeted attacks work. And we talked about the anatomy of a targeted and persistent attack and how attackers move through the enterprise. And then we gave the users tools and techniques to protect themselves. The attendance to these was pretty good. Word traveled fast and people found them interesting. Now, we still had the online version and it was a brand new thing, so our numbers only went up a little bit. But here's the deal. When you start talking to end users about this sort of a thing, you know, cyber is cyber. It's an interesting thing that's not necessarily fully understood. So believe it or not, I had users come up to me after these presentations and ask, can you show us how one of these attacks actually work? Can you show us the attack on screen? Can you show us the whole process so we can see it? And I went, absolutely we can. That'd be awesome. So in 2014, we did it. We started our first hacking demos. We got rid of all of our previous online versions. And in this particular instance, we created an online version of this so that all participants could see. We abandoned the purchased ones. I got a lot of advice from Lance Bittner and Ed Skotis in the first putting this together, because this was my first one. In this one, the fly fishing hack that costs millions, by the way, let me tell you a little bit about how these work. They're about an hour long, okay? The first section actually is an introduction, kind of talking about what's going on in the industry, what's going on in current events, maybe showing a video like anatomy of an attack from Cisco or something like that to get them interested, kind of wet their whistle. Then there's the hacking demo in the middle, And then from there, we follow up by using the last third of the presentation to walk through the steps of the hacking demo and give them tools and techniques to protect themselves. In this particular one, the fly fishing hack that cost millions, we together as a group did some reconnaissance on a particular user to put together the juiciest email we could to get that person to click on that link. And when the user did, we got access to their account, took advantage of a flash vulnerability to do so, escalated our privileges, and then moved around on the network until we got access to some really juicy HR information about them. So this was actually, the attendance jumped up significantly for these. These were interesting. So we did it again in 2015. This one was called Cyber Wars. Cyber Wars was themed after the upcoming Star Wars film. Matter of fact, we started it by showing the trailer to the Star Wars film that was upcoming on the big screen with big booming speakers, and everybody applauded, and it kind of got them in the mood. In this particular hacking demo, we did a privilege escalation attack. We talked about why it's bad to do your day-to-day computing as an administrator. We had two examples that we used. The first was a user that was bent on convenience. He wanted things easy, just one sign-in, access to everything. His name was Darth Vader. And so we showed that once we had access to Darth Vader's account, how easy it was to escalate our privileges and get access to the plans to the Death Star. Then there was a second user who was much wiser, and this user was Yoda. Yoda understood that to get access to the most important thing, he needed to escalate his privileges using a separate account and make sure that those credentials don't match. And in doing so, we showed the users how much harder it was for us to get access to the plans for the Rebel attack. We did a Wi-Fi Man in the Middle attack video by James Lyon and Sophos, which is absolutely fantastic. Check it out. This took off. This really took off. Our attendance soared. Now, here was the cool thing. Not so much the numbers, but we were hearing when we were doing this that users were actually telling each other, you need to see security awareness training. And that was really cool. It was like, wow, that's a goal. People want to see this stuff. It was cool. So we did it again in 2016. This particular presentation was influenced by the Sweet Meteor of Death, which is a Twitter account that ran for president in 2016 and lost. And in this particular presentation, we did the destruction of an entire organization because of one bad password. And we focused on credentials being exposed in the cloud and how their credentials are available for a hacker to log. There's interfaces on the internet that the attackers can attempt to log in as them. And so what we did is we showed them how easy it was to determine accounts based upon internet reconnaissance. Just ask Google. And then from there, we did password spraying against the organization until we got one account. Once we had that one account, we used that account to get into the organization and exfiltrate all of their Outlook address books. So we had access to everyone's account name so we could use that for password spraying. Then what we turned around is we abused Outlook rules to tell our victim's computer to shovel us a shell out to where we are, and we got remote access without the user doing anything, all because of that one bad password. This was fantastic in the sense that it did result in a major update to our password policy, as well as some implementation of two-factor authentication within those instances. So this one was a lot of fun. We're still working on what's going to come up in 2018. I think for those of you who do know this, it will probably involve something related to a cockroach. No, I guess not a lot of Derby Con attendees here. Okay, impact on our organization. Average government phishing click rate, right around 20-21%, seems to be the standard norm. Ours was just about that bad in 2011. We got hit by the Zeus Trojan. And when we did, our click rate was 21%, and it was not a lot of fun. But here's the thing. We were measuring. We were measuring our awareness training through basically doing these phishing tests on a regular basis. As we began to do this live training, we began to see this click rate drop. And until now, it's right around 3-4%. Now, is that great? Maybe, although it really only takes a few users to get inside the organization. It's never going to be perfect. But the thing that was cool about this is during the last phishing test we did, Over 70% of our users recognized it as illegitimate and submitted it through the proper channels. So we saw some positive stuff there as well. Let's talk about some of the themes to these demos and how they work. The first theme is that we become the bad guys. I stand up in front of a group of users and say, hey, we're all going to become the bad guys today, and we're going to go after this individual, because users absolutely love that. And we're going to steal some information, we're going to exfiltrate it, and we're going to sell it on the internet. And we target a person within the organization, because this is about human security awareness training. This isn't about buffer overflows. This isn't about exposed vulnerable PHP or you know, various other things like that. This is about educating users on the control that they have. And so we're focusing on doing a person within the organization. And in many cases, we are going to target a user by using their social media content against them, to perform external reconnaissance against them, find out as much as we can, and how easy it is to do and create that specially crafted email. It's absolutely fascinating when you show users this, because what happens? They're always posting stuff on the internet, on social media about themselves, and they don't think about it being used in a bad way, about it being turned around and twisted to be used against them. And when you show them how easy it is to do that with the information that's available about themselves, they look at it differently and their perspective changes and they go, wow, anything I posted on the internet is something that can be used against me. And it definitely changes the paradigm there as far as things go. The other thing we do is we keep these demos pretty simple. We're not talking about buffer overflows here. We're not talking about major high-tech stuff. What we're doing is we're talking about the fundamentals as far as they relate to the human and the ability of attacker to use them to get inside and steal important information, not only business information, but also personal information. But at the same time, we keep these real. We let the users know that everything they're going to see is real. There are no camera tricks in the background with regards to these. So in all the years I've done these, I have never once ever mentioned the name of a tool that might scroll across the screen. Why? Because I don't have to. You're telling a story. You're not going to just show code flying across the screen. You're going to interrupt this with graphics that show exactly what the hacker's doing, what its next step is. And of course, the obligatory kitten and doggy pictures, right? Those things are important to communicate with the user so that they know what's going on throughout the attack. But what's more important is that they see that there are multiple phases to an attack. In other words, we get a lot of users who will call us or send us an email, and they've clicked on a link and opened an attachment, and something's executed on their system. And oftentimes they'll say, oh my God, did I just surrender all the information from the organization to hackers? And we explain to them, it's like, no, because there's more phases than that. And so when the user realizes that there's more phases, it also means that not only do they understand the importance of blocking it in the first phase, they understand that there are other phases within their control, things that they do in terms of their day-to-day computing, having different credentials for different levels of access, those sorts of things, that can make it much harder for an attacker to be successful. So showing those phases is really important so that they understand those things. Finally, we become them. Kind of like Neo in the movie The Matrix, when he dives into Agent Smith and kind of takes over his body, we kind of give that illustration that when you surrender your credentials to a bad guy, that bad guy not only has access to everything you have access to, but everything they're going to do from this point forward, they will do as you. And users think about things differently when they realize that. It's a whole different world. And so they understand that, and we'll talk about a little bit more of that in a second. So users are always fascinated when they see credit card information, you know, being stolen from a keylogger, and it's all cool and fun, and they're oohing and on, but we tell them, you know, we'll just use that to buy something on Amazon later, because that's not really what we're here for. We're here for something more important. We're here to spy and see where that important HR information is so we can steal that PII and sell it on the internet. But here's what's important. The end users oftentimes have this kind of lackadaisical attitude about their own accounts. Oh, especially in union environments, oh, it's an account that I have that gives access to county information, and if I accidentally do something, yeah, I might get in trouble, but nothing ultimately going to happen to me. And, you know, they don't understand that it's more than that. And so what we do in these demos is we've shown them how easy it is once we get access to your account to log into the HR system and not only get access to all your information that you have online about yourself in HR and ESS, but also set up another bank account to receive your next paycheck. And when they understand that their accounts protect not only the business, but they also protect their information, it changes their whole attitude. And they can see this stuff in action. Let's talk about making these demos effective and improving your awareness metrics. This is probably the most important slide of them all. These are not just hacking demos. You are arming users. When I first did these, before we handed out cheat sheets, we used to hand cheat sheets with a bunch of links for all the tools and techniques so that people did that. Before we did that, people were just writing these things down like crazy because we'd walk through the attack afterwards and we talk about, here's all the things that you can do. Here's the tools we're empowering you with that you can take advantage of at home and protect your home environment as well. Because you see, the line is blurring and most people don't have access to the same tools we have access to in the enterprise. They just don't have those things. But there are a lot of free tools out there that emulate a lot of those same tools that they can easily use in their home environment. If they receive an email with a link on it, a lot of times at work, they'll just send it to us and we'll do some research and tell them whether we think it's safe or not. But we show them how we do that too so that they can do the same thing if they're on their own. And as they learn how to do this stuff, the light opens and they become much more suspicious. And they see things from a different perspective. We teach them how to check to see if their browser's up to date and how to use two-factor authentication, how even that alone would have stopped an attacker's tracks in many of our demos. And basically a number of other tools and techniques that they can use to examine and make sure that their actions are under control in the sense that they know exactly what they're doing, that they're verifying everything that they can. Here's the other thing we do. We don't just show users how social engineering works. We show them how to socially engineer. We teach them how it works. We teach them how to do it. And this actually opens eyes because it generates an attitude of suspicion. It generates, they see this stuff in action and it changes things. We did something this last year, I'm not sure if we're one of the first organizations ever to do this or not, but it was a lot of fun. We did a social engineering contest in our organization. We invited everybody, participation was optional. Everybody to be able to do all the online online reconnaissance of a particular individual and then gather as much information as they can to create a very specially crafted email that they think that user would be hard for them to not fall for. And we got a bunch of submissions. As a matter of fact, it took a long time. The security team reviewed them all, and it took a long time for us to figure out who the top five were. Top five winners got $50 Amazon gift cards, so there was definitely a motivation there. If you want to learn about how this worked, as well as see the top five winners, you can go to my blog at w6fdo.com, and there are blog entries on how we did our social engineering contest. But again, it was in par with doing this as part of the live awareness training hacking demos, showing people how easy it is to do, teaching them how to do it so that they become more suspicious, so that their eyes open. The other thing that happens every once in a while, as you can imagine, is people see this stuff in action and they think, wow, you know, I could go home and download Kali Linux and scan my neighbor's router. And of course, the first thing that we do is if anybody's interested in learning this stuff, we encourage them, absolutely do so. But do so in an ethical manner, find the ethical training, and we point them to that training, and never, ever, ever scan or do anything against anything that you do not explicitly own, and that includes anything in your business without written permission. So that's a really important thing to add. Let's talk about the creation tips with regards to these presentations. This is a little bit older slide when I did this talk at the SANS Security Awareness Summit. Because at that point, I had been doing everything in a virtual environment and then recording it and videoing it. And that works great. Virtual environments are perfect for that sort of a thing, especially if you're not quite sure of the impact in your testing and various other things. It makes sense. Virtual environments are great. You can video it. You can put it together. You can edit, do all that sort of a thing. But since then, I have actually changed that. Because a lot of the more recent demos, we have basically, once the user has surrendered their credentials, we've laid off the land. We're using PowerShell and WMI and various other things to get as far as we can in the environment to get access stuff. It's stuff that we do all day, all the time in our pen testing against our own environment, so the reality is it's perfectly safe if you know what you're doing. So if you do know what you're doing, I would encourage you to actually do some of this stuff on your production network, because we actually have. We've done these demos using the production network as the place where the demos are staged, and users see that and they see real things that they recognize, and it becomes even more real to them as well. Doing demos live is fun at DEF CON. If you're doing a POC, you know, and you're just praying that the demo gods will be good to you. But doing this, if you're going to be doing a presentation over and over and over again, it's really close to impossible. And the last thing you want is people sitting around if you're rebooting a virtual machine and, you know, that sort of a thing. So what I recommend, and this is what I've always done, is that you plan out what you want to present. You add your graphic slides in the middle. You add your slides that describe exactly what's happening and various other things so that it's useful to an end user where they understand it, and at the same time, they still see the real attack in progress. I've polled my users over and over and over again, and we do pilot groups of these all the time, and I ask them, and I try to pick the most non-technical users I can find, and I ask them, is any of this over your head? And consistently I get a no, because we try to make it so that even though they're seeing technical stuff that they may not understand, they're seeing in action something, and then they're seeing all the supporting evidence to it as well. So anyways, what we do is we plan it out, and then we record it, and then we take it from there and do all of our editing and various other things. That way you can create a concise demo that will repeat over and over again. And that's very helpful, especially with regards to time. So for example, say you're running a command, say it's in Metasploit or something like that, and you hit enter and it takes 10 seconds for that command to execute. Well, as you're recording that, you can just snap out those 10 seconds so it moves fast. And then you just pause as you need to while you're going through the presentation on your own. And it makes it much easier to flow through things, and it really does help tremendously rather than trying to do anything like this live, especially obviously if you're doing it on a production network. There are a lot of tools available for this, and I won't go into all the tools that are available, but this one is my favorite. It's the one I use called Camtasia, and the reason why I like it is two things. Number one, it's not expensive, less than $200 a year for a license. And secondly, I haven't found anything yet it can't do. Now, a lot of you can do some way better stuff than I've done, and you'll see where you can get access to my stuff in a minute. But, and so, you know, you may need some more advanced tools for doing some more advanced stuff if you want to do it, some special effects and stuff, but Camtasia is fantastic for that sort of stuff. If you use a real person in your example, and I highly encourage you to do so, make sure you do get their permission. And what do I mean by, that person in your example? If we as a group here, say we're in awareness training, we're going after an individual, you know, it's even more interesting to the users if you can get that individual who's going to volunteer to be the target, or the fake target in this sense, but the target that's used in the example, if you can get that person to volunteer, who is someone who everybody in the audience would love to show up to the company picnic and pay $5 to throw the ball to throw them in the dunk tank. If that's the kind of person you can get, that's awesome, because people are like, yeah, let's get that guy, you know. Let's get the CAO. We're in union negotiations, yeah. So that always makes for more interest. Using real people, real circumstances, the more real you can make it, the better. I mean, I'm all for, you know, storytelling and stuff like that, but the more real you can make it to the end users, the more interested they tend to be, at least from my experience. Resources for training. There's a lot of stuff out there if you want to learn how to do this sort of thing. There's obviously a lot of online CTFs, a lot of vulnerable machines on VulnHub to learn a lot of different things. There's study from Offensive Security, which is great stuff. The fundamental course that I require all my staff to go to, and they have to maintain certification, is SEC 504, Hacker Tools, Techniques, Exploits, and Incident Handling. This is from SANS. John Strand's course, that is definitely a foundation. Then there's Ed Skotis's course, SEC 560, Network Penetration Testing and Ethical Hacking, if you want to take it to the next level and learn all the tools in detail of how to do this sort of thing. And then you can just turn around and video stuff. SANS NetWars, it's happening here at RSA. Check the last session's happening now, so obviously it's too late. But next time you're at a conference where SANS NetWars is presented, take advantage of it. You will learn a tremendous amount from it. It is absolutely fantastic. what they have done with that court, with that online competition. And of course, Sands Holiday Hack, which is available online. You can Google that, happens every year. A great learning resource as well. If you don't want to do it yourself, maybe your staff would love to do this for you. Maybe they go, oh yeah, that'd be great. And then you can just do the presentation part. That's fine. There's a lot of online stuff too. I've used a number of Jeff Lyons' videos from Sophos with his and Sophos' permission as well. And there's lots of stuff from YouTube, again, that you can use. Cut and paste, again, get the permission of the user, of the person who owns it. All the previous presentations that I have done are online. Now, they may have been edited a little bit for the sake of the content, but they are all available online on the YouTube page. These are yours to use however you see fit. There are a number of organizations all over the world that are currently using these as part of their security awareness training. Do whatever you want. Download them, hack them up, change them any way you see fit. Heck, you can load it into Camtasia, separate the audio from the video, get rid of my voice, and put your own voice over the top of it. I don't care, that's great. Just if you do use them, please share them, because this is my contribution, my gift to the security, information security community. So definitely want more people to know about them, that sort of a thing. So check them out, and hopefully I have a new one coming up here real quick. Applying what you learned today, basically if you're interested in doing this, pull your users within your environment. See what their interest might be. And make sure you are regularly measuring through phishing testing, your awareness levels. Make sure you're regularly measuring that. If you need to learn how to do that, check out Lance Bittner's course from Sands. It's great for learning how to do that in baseline and measure it successfully and consistently. And then afterwards, prepare a walkthrough and video it, and then sit down with a pilot group of just regular end users and have them look at it and ask them, is this interesting? Does this help you? Is this something that you might find successful? And then, after you get that feedback, once you decide to do it, present it to your users, ask for feedback, and consistently measure as you're going along your awareness training to see if your awareness metrics to see if they're changing, especially with regards to phishing. Because suspicion is what we're trying to generate here more than everything. Healthy suspicion, so that users are empowered and they realize that they don't have to just be scared. They have these tools and techniques that they can use as well to be successful against the bad guys. That's it. We have about 15 minutes. If we have any questions, you can come up to the microphones. Any questions at all? Come up to the mic. Isn't that a cute cat? Yeah. I love Siamese.
This is somewhat unrelated, but who is your design person for your posters?
Oh, that's a great question. His name is... I'm blanking now. Who is his name, Anita? And this is weird. He has an interesting, unusual name. I can post it. It's not a big deal, but we are very, very, very fortunate to have a great graphics designer and on our staff. And I don't work with him that much, obviously. Otherwise, I'd remember his name a little bit better. But he's absolutely fabulous. And if you have the opportunity to find somebody who can do that for you, it really, really helps a lot. It's great stuff.
So for that first run through, that first year, how did you generate interest? Did you send out announcements, emails, let people know it's coming?
Yes, lots of advertising. Lots of little spurts like come learn this, and you know, kind of like you're throwing out little spurts to a new film or something like that. It's really basically mostly through email. And again, it took the first year, attendance was pretty good, and then as people learned about it and word traveled, yeah, then it became more of a wave, and now our attendance has just been fabulous.
And everything was done in-house? I mean, you use your own people for the
hacking?
Everything
was done in-house, yeah. Everything was done 100% in-house, and really, really great stuff.
One more. So you said get permission from whoever you're going to use, but assuming you're going to phish them, do you get permission beforehand? Does that not raise their suspicions, or...?
Actually, in this situation, what we're doing is we're doing more of a simulation. So, you know, you're using that user and you're using their account and you're using information about them, but you're not actually phishing them and expecting them to action. You're doing you're simulating the environment. So you're pretending basically that they did, and then you're seeing the actions that you can do after you have successful access to them.
Okay. So.
Thank you very much. It was a great presentation.
Thank you.
Can you utilize the decisions to actually show the value of the controls that you have already implemented? For example, if there is an escalation of privileges, mm-hmm. okay, do you show that this is why users, we don't give you admin privileges on workstations? Something like this.
Yeah, we do emphasize that. Part of the issue, though, is, like I said, the governance thing.
Okay.
Is that a lot of departments kind of do whatever they feel like, you know, they're going to do. And so it's as well, you know, convincing them that, hey, this is the best perspective from your users, you know, from your users in terms of controlling their environments better. So, yeah, we do. Does that answer your question?
I mean, yes, to a certain extent, because what I'm looking for is, you know, it's a look chain. It's a chain.
Yes.
It's a tech chain. And what we want is to make sure that in all the steps,
yes.
defensive depth
exactly.
approach, you have mitigated the control. This is why you are doing this.
Exactly.
This is why so you are showing people the attack or the threats, and you're also telling them that there is a solution for this. This is why we implement this.
Yes.
All the way within the chain.
Exactly. That's
yes.
exactly the goal. There's no
okay.
question. Yeah.
Good.
All throughout those different phases.
Yes.
And it's really important that users understand. I mean, everybody wants single sign-on and ease of use. And that's fine if you have multiple factors or different elements involved. But most people don't live that in their day-to-day lives. And so they're using the same password and username across every single
yes.
account that they have in their environment. And they change that pretty quickly. At least we hope they do. But most of them do say, oh, God,
yes.
I got to get in changing my stuff and start using a password manager and turn it on 2FA everywhere they can and on and on and on and on. So, yeah, we do
okay.
emphasize and focus
also,
on that.
One more question. Do you have something directed to probably some senior management executives?
We do a little different version for the department heads
okay.
and the board supervisors, yes.
Okay.
So we tweak it a little bit, but not a lot. We keep it pretty much the same level because
okay.
they're interested as human beings the same way the rest of us are.
Is this version also available on the website?
No, that version's not.
Okay. So. Thank you
Thank
very
you.
Much.
Yes.
Do you mind sharing details on how you got buy-in, what your budget was, FTEs dedicated to this, and also how many hours were committed?
In terms of number of hours, I mean, it's not all at once, obviously. It's over a period of time. It usually takes about 3 months to develop a presentation and present it. In terms of FTEs and hours, to be honest with you, most of this work has I've just done it myself. And so there hasn't been a large, you know, what's more important is that my staff be able to handle everything else, obviously, when you're doing this sort of a thing. What it has done is it really has, you know, when the department heads and the CAO see this stuff, they have that same reaction. And so I know that with budget cuts right now and hiring freezes that, you know, I'm in pretty good shape. I'm not saying that to, you know, if you're watching, yeah. You know what I mean. But bottom line is that I feel like there's a lot of confidence in terms of the importance of this sort of stuff for our end users. So I can't really give you an FTE or budgeted number to do this, no. Not at this point.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome.
Have you ever had anybody walk into you and say, I'm interested in a career change after seeing this?
Yeah, we've had a number of people actually want to get involved in information security, which is really, really cool, including guys sitting over here who basically have seen this sort of stuff and go, wow, I really want to learn this stuff. And we just definitely encourage that as much as we can. Yes, go ahead.
Hi. Thank you for the presentation. So I was wondering, you said you set it up as a simulation for
yes.
the phishing, and then when you penetrate and escalate,
yes.
the actual data that you show, is it real data?
No, we make sure we're not showing real data on the screen.
Okay.
No, absolutely
okay.
not.
So do you have to create a whole like environment of like simulated data?
No, not necessarily, because like for example, in the one you saw there where we got access to HR files,
mm-hmm.
those HR files were pretty much real, but we never showed the contents
okay.
of them. And so when we were exfiltrating those files, you just saw the file names go across. And we actually changed the file
names
a little bit.
You didn't see names of employees or anything?
We changed the file names a little bit to protect the innocent. But for the most part, you can be very creative. What I do now, like I said, we do a lot of stuff live on the production network. But sometimes when it comes to the real meat of stuff, I will just simulate that. Because obviously you're still trying to protect the environment, especially if you're going to, you know, I do tweak these so before they get published out on the internet, but bottom line is that, you know, there's information in there, and you just want to be very, very careful in the steps you take, but still be as real as possible. And that's the really important thing, is just to make it so that people understand that, hey, this is really happening, or this really happened on this network, and it's not just some, you know, make-believe story, so to speak.
And you said you always get people to give their consent beforehand. Has anyone ever regretted it after they've seen the results?
No, not so far. As a matter of fact, we did one where we turned on the video camera and spied on a conversation in an office. And they're still in there, and they love it every time they hear themselves be on screen, you know. But again, that was simulated as well. But the point was, you know, to let them know that those capabilities are there. So,
thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else?
Sure. Does this augment your normal, like, yearly required training, or is it do you have another training program for that, or is this?
No, this is it. We focus purely on this, and since we do it annually, you know, we like to just make it like, here's the latest thing, and we want to make this exciting and interesting for you, and you know, something that's so users understand that they only have to go to the one that at least we think is exciting, and then they don't. From there, there's nothing else that they have to do other than new employee awareness training, which is something different. That happens when they first sign up. Yes. No, not really. And here's the reason why. Sure. He was asking. If you do these realistic demos, aren't you creating an opportunity for hackers to hack inside your organization by seeing this stuff? And the answer is no, and here's why. If somebody really wants inside of our organization, they don't need these videos. they really don't. And secondly, there's nothing in here that they wouldn't already know if they have the skills to get inside. So basically put, and they can do this with any organization. It applies across the board. So there's nothing that's super specific about our organization. But basically, there's a, you know, we try to keep it as generic as possible, but we're really not worried about that in that sense. So, thank you so much for being here. This is great. Thanks a lot. Appreciate it.